All right. Yeah, I mean that might be workable then. Okay. Yeah. All right. I'll let you know. I'll let you know.
Eight.
All right. Okay, the recording, everything started. Cool, cool, cool. Hey everyone, Anthony Fantano here, internet's busiest music nerd. I hope you're doing well, and we are here for an exclusive interview and conversation with the one and only Little Sims. New record, I Might Be Introvert, is out now. I'm loving it. A lot of you guys in chat are loving it. We're going to be talking about that and anything else that comes up in the conversation. First off, so the record's out, people have been digesting it. What do you feel about the reception so far? Have you been pretty excited about it?
Yeah, for sure. There's just been so much love, man. So much love from all angles. I think people just genuinely just excited for new music from me. I know coming off the back of Grey Area and then even doing Drop Six last year, it just feels like there was a what's going to be next? What's the direction? What's the sound? You know, I felt that in the lead up to it. So now that it's out, the love's just been overflowing.
Do you feel like you fucked up a lot of people's album of the year lists?
What, got it in at the buzzer quickly? I don't know. Do you?
I think so. That's what the conversation around the water cooler seems to be, that a lot of album of the year lists, you know, got fucked up. And, you know, considering the huge drops that, you know, came out the week that you came out, everybody saying they didn't even have the best record. You had the best record of, you know, those 2 weeks. So
crazy. That in itself is, I think, more hard to digest and get my head around because people are like comparing my album to Kanye, Drake, or whoever it is, you know. But even just to be in the conversation, like, I think is great. And obviously these are rappers that I've grown up listening to and I respect. So just to see my name amongst that is pretty crazy. It's cool though.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I feel like when it comes to big drops like that in the industry, there's usually like a lot of fear and hesitance about like coming out with music around the same week, because, you know, you sort of get drowned in the hype or whatever. But, you know, I think you and your record have shown that, like, if you show up with an album that, you know, genuinely hits people in an emotional way, you know, it doesn't really matter. You know, the art speaks for itself and it sort of cuts through the conversation.
For sure. And it's like you said, I think it's just knowing that confidence in yourself and in your art. And also I announced the record coming out back in April.
Sure.
And I know, like, to announce an album in April and then have people wait the whole spring, the whole summer, get to fall. I couldn't do that to people. You know, I couldn't be like, by the way, I've got to move it because it's I stuck to it. I said it was coming September 3rd. Mm-hmm. And I delivered, and it's kind of this. I remember the same thing actually happened to me on Grey Area, where Solange dropped the same day. This is just like a thing with me. I'm starting to realize, but I remember Solange dropped the same day, and I remember being like, "Ah, oh, that's it." Then no one's. I'm a Solange fan. I'm not even going to listen to my album when it drops, you know.
Right.
But I think through the. I'm trying to make music that will stand the test of time. So whether people listen to it on that day or a week, 2 weeks, a month later, I think it will hopefully still resonate and have the same effect, you know?
You know, in your rhymes on this record, especially on your last record as well, there's a lot of themes of, you know, being the underdog and I guess, you know, also being discounted artistically on account of, you know, being a woman. And, you know, considering the reception of this record so far and the conversation around it, do you feel like, you know, the meta around that is improving? Do you feel like you're being taken more seriously? Do you think you're being maybe not underrated, but more properly or appropriately rated, you know, in the wake of this record?
Yeah, for sure. I think it's a few things. I think people like an underdog, you know what I'm saying? People like to support that artist that, you know, isn't that known or not many people know. It still feels like it's yours, it's, you know, and you hold that. The minute it's exposed to the masses, it's kind of like it takes away from it being yours. So I think that's maybe one of the reasons people run with that narrative. But in the time that I've been coming up and releasing albums and doing my thing, I do see a shift. I haven't I mean, obviously I'm based in London, so I do see it a lot more in the UK, but even stateside, like I've definitely felt like the whole female rapper sort of, when it comes to me anyway, it's not really a thing anymore. It's just people just put me as, yeah, she's one of the dopest, or she's just a great rapper or artist, you know, which is always what I was striving for, because I've never liked to be boxed, you know what I mean? You hear my album, there's so many different styles, even though it's rooted in hip hop, there's so many different influences there. So would you call it a hip hop album? Maybe, mm-hmm. But Protect My Energy is not a hip hop song. You know,
well, so. Exactly. I think that's kind of something I wanted to get into at some point during the conversation. Like, sure. Considering that track and also some of the West African influences on songs on the back end of the record, how important was it for you on this LP to switch it up so in such a stark way artistically, and like really give fans some different genres and kind of see you in a different light?
Yeah, I think it's always been part of my artistry. Like, I've never felt like linear. I've never felt just like doing one thing. I've always been inspired by different styles, and especially diving into the West African space. Obviously my parents are from Nigerian heritage, and before anyone knew or cared about Sims, I was diving into that space anyway. Mm. You know what I mean? So it's just now I had the opportunity on this album to really just be confident with it and be more bold with it. And if there was a record I'm going to do this on, it's going to be this one. I'm probably never going to make an album like this again. Do you know what I'm saying? But that's cool, because I had the opportunity to do it this time, and I got out all the crazy ideas. I've recorded this in the middle of a pandemic. You know what I'm saying? There was so much uncertainty in the world, and I thought, well, if this is going to be my last album, I'm going crazy, you know? And I got the opportunity to do that. So I think, but also I enjoy doing that. You know, it's not a force. It's not like, oh, I've got to do this so I can fit into the dance space, or so I can be popping in Africa. I just genuinely love this music and I enjoy it. And I'm working with a producer that is also very in flow, that is also very versatile and isn't afraid to try those things also.
Yeah. When you say like another album like this again, are you talking about in terms of like the sounds that you're bringing to the table here, the themes that you're approaching? I mean, I did get kind of the sense after listening to this that there was almost like a continuation of that that lushness and that almost like fairy tale kind of influence that we got on Stillness in Wonderland. But that seems to have come to like, you know, full potential and fruition here. So again, like when you say not another album like this again, is that because you feel like you've accomplished something here that you don't need to continue pushing forward with, or is it something else?
Exactly. Like, I think I've tried to execute this to the highest level possible. Do you know what I mean? Like, and so where I'm at, you know, right now, I'm probably going forward. I feel I want to try something else and I want to, you know, explore in a different space, and whether that's, I could go completely boom bap and it'll still bang. Like, I'm still going to do my thing in that. So, and also I think it's nice to like look back in 10 years when someone looks at a Little Sims catalog and say, oh yeah, I remember that. And I remember where I was at in that time in my life when this album dropped. And you know what I'm saying? I think it's nice to just, for it to just be as what's the word? Like, for lack of a better word, different each project, you know?
Yeah.
I think Stillness in Wonderland, I was trying to go for something that maybe I didn't, it made sense in my head, but I think the execution of it wasn't fully there. And I think with this album, I kind of had the opportunity to do it, and I was going for it, you know?
Kind of continuing off of something that you were mentioning earlier about like your reception and the love that you've been getting in the UK, you know, do you feel like, you know, what you're contributing artistically is helping, I guess, this momentum that a lot of people have been seeing as of late, where it seems like Britain is like really kind of expanding its influence in the hip hop space in general, that it's not just like having a moment, but it's like, you know, really kind of putting up, you know, pulling a chair up to the table in a big, big way, to where, you know, we're not just talking about one rapper at a time every once in a while. We're talking about the whole scene, like on the whole, and it's like having an impact and and bringing artists that we're talking about, you know, to the table every year consistently at this point. Yeah. You know, do you get that same sense?
For sure, definitely, especially, yeah, especially now. It's crazy. I mean, sometimes when you're in it, you don't see it. It's hard to gauge because you're a part of it. But when I step outside, or I've been doing like a festival run and stuff, and before, I remember growing up, it was like all the artists from the States come in to the UK, and there might have been one person from the UK that's on the lineup. But now our lineup is like majority UK acts, you know what I'm saying? Okay. And that's when I am outside of the bubble and I see, oh, okay, there's a demand for this and people are loving the sound right now. And I think everyone's just growing their confidence in wanting to make music that goes beyond just London or just the UK, you know. And outside of that, people are actually being receptive to it, you know. People will listen to my album and be like, okay, maybe I should check out someone else from London, or listen to a Dave, or listen to whoever it is, you know what I mean? So yeah, I think everyone's helping each other in that sense with bringing out dope music.
Moving on from there, I wanted to ask you about some of the topics of the album itself. Given how personal this record is, were there any songs that you'd like to go into, or, you know, sort of like themes that you'd like to go into that at the point, you know, prior to completing the record, were maybe particularly hard to write or write about, maybe given, you know, how much you'd kind of be revealing in the process of completing this album?
Yeah, well, I guess one of the main ones is definitely I Love You, I Hate You.
Yeah.
Just simply because of the subject matter and me having to confront things and be so open and vulnerable with my audience. And I remember being super like, I don't want this song to go on my album. Like, I'd write it and it could be a hard drive classic, but that's fine. Like, I don't know if I want the world to know like that, you know. But I'm super glad I done it, and the reception after, with people hitting me up saying, oh, I'm not an artist, but you've literally just articulated how I've been feeling for most of my life. I think those moments and those messages and that kind of reception makes it worth it. I Love You, I Hate You, for sure. Maybe Misunderstood. Well, let me say this about I Love You, I Hate You as well. One of the things that I felt holding me back from releasing the song is putting it out is because I didn't want to give like my dad the stage like that. I don't want to feed his ego, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, I'm out of her life and she's still writing about me, and I didn't want him to get that. But I think it was more about me and wanting to not walk around hoarding this anger for this person that I barely even know. And seeing the effect it's had on my life with relationships, with friendships, all of these, I didn't want to carry that anymore. You know what I mean? So it was an important song for me to fully let go. And the same with Misunderstood. A lot of people feel like I could have ended it on How Did You Get Here? And I agree, you know what I mean? But I think, like I said, making the album the time I did, so much uncertainty, me feeling like, well, if this is going to be the last one, then I'm going to say everything, you know what I mean? And I know if I put the album out and cut it at How Did I Get Here, there would have always been that thing within me that's like, I wish I just said what I wanted to say, you know what I mean, with Misunderstood. So if anything, that was probably just a selfish thing just for me, but I understand that How Did You Get Here could have kept it, but...
No, I mean, I think the way that you ended it was great. It kind of ended it on, you know, more of a golden note, and, you know, left things in more of a positive space with the way that you finished it.
Sure.
You know, outside of the realm of your father, was there anybody or anything else that you sort of needed to think about or check in with in terms of like, you know, I need to think about how this person might be portrayed on the record, or this situation might be portrayed on the record, and sort of make sure that they're okay with that, you know, because of just, again, just everybody sort of and everything in your orbit that you're kind of bringing up in the sense of this album.
Yeah. And that's a difficult thing as well, trying to, the fine line between obviously revealing things about my life, but it doesn't, I'm not the only person in the story.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, but everyone I'm around and that knows me knows that I've always written music from a very reflective and introspective place. So I don't think it's necessarily a shocker to hear some of the subject matters or some of the things I talk about, because they know I'm that type of artist, you know? I did have some really real conversations with some friends during the making of the album that had, I guess, inspired like certain lines and certain things, especially on Introvert. I had a really deep conversation with one of my tight friends of 15 years. And we just, it was just really real. Like, she just was like, you know, these are the moments where I feel like you haven't been there for me when your career's done this. And this is where I felt excluded. This is where I felt left behind. And I had to sit with that. Do you know what I mean? And I had to take it on a chin and acknowledge it. And I guess it prompted a lot of the questions. Sim's the artist or Sim be the person. Like, all these things are coming from real conversations that I'm having with people in my life, you know?
Going off of that, I also wanted to ask you about just the way introversion plays into the record overall. And, you know, you're talking about how, you know, the industry and, you know, doing what you do for a career is kind of affecting these personal relationships. But, you know, it's kind of existing professionally as an artist is such an interpersonal thing in and of itself. And it requires like so much networking, so much interaction, and, you know, so many like connections with people who you may not sort of know off the bat or have a connection with prior, or may not even know, you know, whether or not you should trust them. So I guess like as a result, you know, in what ways do you feel like introversion kind of impacts, you know, your day to day, just in terms of like trying to accomplish what you're trying to accomplish, and how do you kind of fight through that? You know, it's like at what points in your career and with your work do you find yourself to be most introverted and you need to find a way to break through it?
Interesting. I think with, I've always known that I'm introverted. I just didn't know that was the term for it.
Right.
I've always known I'm very to myself. And even though people see me on stage and think, well, I don't get that. How can you be on stage performing to 10,000 people, but you call yourself an introvert? That's a bit backwards. But actually, I've always felt my way of expressing myself has always been through my art. I find I communicate, believe it or not, better within my music than I probably do in a conversation. Or I'm going to get better at that, but for a long time that was definitely the case. And I think I'm someone that has put a lot of somewhat pressure on myself also to just not be introverted in that sense. And I think, well, if that's naturally who I am, I want to always bring myself to whatever situation or space I'm in. And I don't want to change that for anyone. And I guess that's basically what my album encompasses, when it's like the interludes, like the rapper that came to tea, like, why do you want to be in these spaces if you feel really uncomfortable? And it's finding comfort within that. Do you know what I'm saying? I think introverts are labeled as shy or like quiet or weird or whatever it is, and it's like, no, I found power within that. Hence why introvert sounds so big and so grand, is because I found power within that introversion, you know.
Yeah.
I don't even know if that answered your question, to be very honest.
No, it does. And to sort of speak to this myself, because, you know, in this way I kind of identified with the record personally. I think a lot of people don't really kind of, or when they think of something like introversion, the first place that their mind goes to is like, I don't know what, like public speaking. And, you know, you're at the podium and you're like, oh, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. But, you know, the thing is, like, if you're in that space and you're doing exactly what you're the most comfortable doing, it's like absolutely, you know, water off a duck's back. It means absolutely nothing. But like for a lot of people, you know, people who are introverts, sometimes the most intimate spaces are the most difficult to navigate, are the most difficult to work through. Because like, you know, in that sense, you're not standing on a podium, you're not on a stage, you're not in that power position, You know what I mean? It's like, you know, you're eye to eye with somebody else, you're on equal footing with somebody else. And if you're insecure or dealing with, you know, issues of introversion, that can like really lock you up in a lot of ways.
Exactly. That's so true. And even like with that, I've always found it's way more difficult for me to perform in a room full of 10 than thousands. But it's funny because this is like, but I started off performing to 10 people. Do you know what I mean? Right. And so it's like, it's weird. And then obviously the numbers grow or whatever, and you start performing to more people, and then going back to that space now feels, this is uncomfortable, do you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, I've been performing for a very long time. I genuinely feel very at home on the stage, and I always have felt, and in the studio also. So yeah, just, and these are also themes that I think I kind of touched on a bit in Grey Area. I know songs like Therapy and whatnot. And then, so moving on to this album, just felt maybe it'd be interesting to dive more into that and talk on it more.
Yeah, kind of referencing back to Therapy and talking about letting go of some of the emotions that, you know, you did on like, I Love You, I Hate You, for example. Getting this record out as a whole, you know, was that kind of a cathartic experience for you? Like I can just kind of like flush out everything I'm talking about on this record and sort of be like, you know, over it and done with it in a way?
Yes, for sure. Definitely. It's a mix of dealing with like the last record and how well that was received, and people feeling like, is she gonna top it? Is it gonna be better? Whatever. But then also dealing with everything that's been on your mind subconsciously and just letting it go. It's just like, I've made an album that I'm really proud of. Here you go. But also I've said everything I feel like I needed to say, and I can be at peace with it. And now I can find through performing or whatever it is, like give the songs new meaning, you know? And now I genuinely believe like these aren't really my songs. Do you know what I mean? Like I'm a firm believer in the higher power, and I feel like I'm being worked through, and someone is, you know, or something is guiding me, and I've let it go. Do you know what I mean? I'm not so attached, and that's why I feel when moving on, I can do whatever I want. You know what I'm saying? I'm just in the moment. I'm just letting the spirit take me.
Talking about the record overall in terms of features, it's, you know, a long LP, almost as long as Stillness in Wonderland, but doesn't have nearly as, you know, many on it. And, you know, was that sort of like, you know, a philosophy that you had going into the record, you know, considering like how personal it was going to be, that you should be like, I guess, kind of like carrying the bulk of the narrative and everything?
Yeah, I just thought I thought Grey Area was like quick fire, cool, right. 10 songs, tight, you know, watertight, whatever. And I felt like this album, I wanted to just expand, really. And that's it. And I'm heavily into film, heavily into narrative and story. And I wanted to tell a story through my music. Now, I understand, like, I don't expect people to bang the interludes in their car. That's not the point of this album. Do you know what I'm saying? It's just you take what you want from it. That's fine. But if you have a moment, there is a story there for you.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's the whole, that's what it was for me. But obviously you take what you want from it, you know, it's open for interpretation.
Well, I mean, you know, to talk about kind of that narrative and even specifically about those interludes, they do kind of bring a very certain kind of flavor and aesthetic to the record, because it does pull from a very particular kind of storytelling. And, sure. You know, like, is there a point in your youth where, again, that sort of like kind of fantastical, almost like, you know, fairy godmother type voice guiding the protagonist, guiding, you know, whoever it is they're talking to. Is there a point in your youth or at some other, you know, moment in your life where a story along those lines or a narrative along those lines like really impacted, you know, you and stuck with you?
Not one I can necessarily put my finger on, but I just want to always make sure I'm taking care of the little Simbi,
right?
You know what I mean? And keeping her on this journey with me as well. Do you know what I mean? Because I think kids are so innocent and they're so smart and they, you know, are so intuitive. And I've always had a great sense of intuition from when I was young, and I just never want to lose that. And I, even when I will watch like a Disney movie right now with like my niece or whatever, and I look at it different, like, oh, that's actually an important life hack or an important message, or, you know what I mean? Whereas when you're kids, you're just soaking it up, whatever. But I think, yeah, I just wanted to take it, to have both sides, the really grown, and you hear it in the songs, the maturity and whatnot. But then also I'm still caring for little Simbi on this journey. I'm still bringing her with me. I'm still guiding her. I'm still protecting her. I'm still here for her, you know? Hmm.
Yeah. I mean, the way that you speak on that, I mean, in a way, is this record, you know, dedicated to your younger self, or kind of like starting a conversation, you know, with your younger self, or saying things that you wish you could have heard at some point?
Yeah, exactly that. Somewhat, yeah. And I've been doing music, you know what I'm saying, my whole life, pretty much. And there's so many things that I've learned, and there's so many mistakes I've made and whatnot. And I just, like, you know, for the next up and coming, whoever, if they can take anything from my music, it's just like, here are some little gems here and there. Do you know what I mean? And not to say my journey is going to work for everyone, but if I can give back in any sense, like, there you go.
I wanted to ask you about a few artists that, you know, you've worked with and have had connections with. One of the most interesting and mysterious projects out of the UK right now being, you know, being Salt. You know, you were on that Nine record that happened recently. Without obviously, like, spoiling too much, because, like, there is sort of an element of secrecy. And I believe, you know, you featured on that new record. Isn't that record still, like, slated to disappear next month? Is that record still... I believe.
You download it.
Yeah. I didn't download it. I've streamed it a few times. But I guess, like, but yeah, I mean, you know, word of warning to anybody.
Download it. Download it. Everyone watching, download that Nine album. Trust me. In 10 years, you're going to be like, yo.
Well, it is a pretty good project. I was hoping to, before, you know, just like you, before the shot clock goes off, you know, maybe get a review for it before it's totally off the internet. But yeah, you know, if you guys are not, you know, aware of S-A-U-L-T, this very anonymous project out of the UK right now, and Sims is featured on the new record, it is going to be sort of going down off the internet next week. So yeah, I mean, so if you could go into a little bit, like, what exactly was that reach out, and, you know, kind of what created that connection that got you involved in the project, and you know, again, without spoiling anything, like, I don't know, like, what from what you've seen, like, what is Salt, and what is kind of like that creative kind of chemistry and collective like?
Yeah, I'm always making music with Salt,
right?
That's like, it's a family. It's a team of great musicians and writers, and it's just a collaborative network, you know. I think, so, you know, some people you would never think are on Salt. They just don't put their name on it, you know what I mean? So
right, listening to all the projects, I kind of got the sense that, like, there's probably a bunch of people on this I know, but it's just they're just not listed.
Yeah, right. And that's, like, I think what's dope about it. Do you know what I mean? It's literally about the music and everyone bringing their talents and bringing their gifts to create something, as opposed to it being who's the face of this or who done what or whatever it is, you know. Right. So that whenever the call comes in to come through and do something, come there, and we've done a bunch of stuff will see the light of day, a bunch of stuff won't. It just feels like a great hub for me to create music with people I really like and get along with and have great musical chemistry with.
Okay.
You know?
I mean, you know, from what you know, after Nine, is there more stuff, you know, kind of coming out soon? And if there is, will those projects maybe see the same like kind of limited shelf life on the internet, or may those stick around?
Yeah, that I don't know.
Okay.
That I have no idea. I just turn up to the studio.
Okay. Well, actually, you know, thank you. Just the kind of like letting me know that there are some people on that we may be aware of, but are just like kind of, you know, jumping in anonymously is kind of what I assumed, and more than I think what, you know, some people have kind of let on so far. So that's great. Thank you. So again, not to dive too much into that and spoil that. Also Gorillaz, you know, a lot of fans going into this interview wanted to ask about just like, you know, your connection there and your collaboration there and how that sort of came to be.
Yeah. So I met Damon through Kano. Kano made the link. And I remember going down to the studio the first time I met him, we made Garage Palace. That was the first meeting.
Right.
And I know we just hit it off. Like, I just admired obviously him, and I've grown up listening to Gorillaz, you know. So being in the space with him and him just allowing me the freedom to do my thing, you know, don't think about the fact that you're in a Gorillaz session, it's fine, just do Sims, was something that will always definitely stick with me. And then him bringing me on tour at the time I just released Stillness in Wonderland was crazy. Do you know what I mean? Some people don't be doing arena tours. Like, that would probably be happening now for most people. Do you know what I mean? So the fact that he seen something in me from early and took that leap of faith was just, yeah, man, I owe him a lot for that, for sure.
Okay.
I came out, they had two shows in London at the O2, which I came out for. And the last time I'd seen them was in like 2017. So it was really nice just to be back with everyone and see the show again. If you haven't seen a Gorillaz show, oof, yeah, it's wild.
You know, also, do you know if Damon's actually like working on volume 2 of Song Machine right now? Is that happening, like, to your knowledge, or?
Damon is always working.
Oh, yeah. No, I got that sense. So, I got that sense.
So he ain't going to leave you high and dry. Let's say that.
Okay.
He's got you.
Okay. I also wanted to ask you about, you know, almost referencing back to what you were saying earlier about, you know, revealing yourself more in your art. And previously, you're not this kind of person that just like spills out everything in their music and spills out everything on social media either. You know what I mean? In terms of like, I'm going to tell you every single thing about me and so on and so forth. But, you know, you did drop this picture on Twitter like a couple of years ago where you met Estelle as a kid. And, you know, she's somebody who I'm thinking of more and more now with like, just for whatever reason, like American Boy having this cultural resurgence over the past several years. I don't know what it is, but that song is like really kind of connecting with Zoomers in a way that I didn't think would ever be possible. How exactly did that happen? Like, you know, when did you run into Estelle and get that in and grab that picture?
I want to say it was at a festival called Afropunk.
Mm. Oh, okay.
Yeah. In London, it was at Alexandra Palace. And yeah, I just honestly, my sister probably just dragged me and was like, Estelle, we've got to get this picture. And I asked her very politely and she gave me the time. And that was that. And I always had that picture. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's fantastic. I wanted to ask you about one of the final moments of the record where you're really kind of going into almost like, you know, your own credentials as like a, you know, a music fan and a music nerd of sorts and really studying music in a way and all the things that you've kind of like learned from it, not only in terms of like your craft, but personally as well. And, you know, I wanted to ask you considering that and considering like anybody who's doing this professionally and doing this seriously is always a student, you know, at all points. Yeah. What right now do you feel like you're still learning or, you know, putting a lot of effort toward, you know, learning or trying to comprehend in terms of, you know, music, either as a concept or something that you just like want to pull off personally as an artist?
Yeah, I think like I really want to master the art of making everything cohesive from from the music to the visual to the artwork to everything surrounding it. I really want to just get better at making that super, super tight, I think. And as well, instruments. I play a bit of keys, a bit of bass here and there. So it'll be nice to, just continue to grow my confidence in that area for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Big fan of bass myself. Put in as much time with that as you want and as you need. You know, what's a record that kind of pops up into your mind, you know, with everything that you just said, that you feel like does that perfectly, you know, like cohesive everything, most cohesive from visual sounds, the tracks, maybe even a narrative if there is a narrative, and maybe even like the rollout of the record too, like in terms of presentation, it's.
That's a good question. I remember at the time J. Cole put out, I think it was Born Sinner. Mm-hmm. And he done like these little, each video was like a short film kind of story.
Right.
I thought that was really cool. And just linking that back to the project, I think Kendrick done that amazingly on To Pimp a Butterfly and Damn, mm-hmm. Where everything felt super, super cohesive. And then even when you go to the live show, that's when it enhances everything and you actually feel like you're in the album, you're in the experience. Probably those off the top of my mind if I'm thinking.
And, you know, obviously to reference back to Gorillaz, like especially a cycle like Plastic Beach is just like so, yeah. I mean, everything about the Gorillaz world is so immersive.
Yeah, very true, very true. Gorillaz do that amazingly for sure.
Yeah.
And like, again, when you're at the show and you just feel like, yeah, I'm at the Plastic Beach. you know what I mean?
So I'm getting a few like questions in chat that I want to throw at you really quickly. Yeah. Scientist Seb wants to know what it was like to get a shout out from K-Dot, and did that actually like pan out into him reaching out like he said? I think he said at the time that it would.
Yeah, that was crazy. I remember being in France when I heard that. Mm-hmm. Random fact, I was with Joey Badass. Mm-hmm. And I saw the clip and I was like, wow, that's insane. And then I had a couple other run-ins with him and a couple other encounters, and it's always been love from him, and he's always shown support. So one day maybe it will happen with a song, but we'll see.
Okay, awesome, good to know. Ask you one more over here. You know, considering that it's something that you mentioned in your music and it's something that's, you know, creatively been in your past, you know, where currently do a lot of your, you know, acting, I guess, like aspirations lie right now? Is there anything like in the works that you have coming down the pipe on that front? Is that something that like you're still kind of, you know, working on currently?
Yeah, for sure. So I have a few projects that, I've been a part of that I can't talk about, but I have just finished the season 4 of Top Boy.
Yeah.
So there's that to look forward to. And I think it's going to be a good one. I think people are going to enjoy it.
Okay.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, listen, I don't want to take up too much more of your time. I appreciate you coming through. It's been great. And it's, you know, again, it's an amazing new record. People are enjoying it for, I think, you know, the right reasons. I think people are like really kind of reading into your stuff in a serious way and, you know, kind of like understanding you in a way that they haven't before, maybe didn't quite get as much on gray area. And it's been exciting for me to see that. I think it's exciting for you to see that. And, you know, anything else that we need to look out for over the next few weeks outside of like the tour dates and everything?
I think, honestly, just keep enjoying the music, man. It's there for you, and thank you as well, because I know you've been supporting for a very long time. So thank you for always showing love and
no problem.
You know what I'm saying? That, yeah, it means a lot for sure. And I hope I hope you can make it to a show, but if not, we'll be able to chop it up in real life soon.
No, so I'll let you know for sure.
Thank you, everyone. I can't see the chat or anyone's like messages.
Everyone's
or whatnot,
messages are just hearts right now. Everyone's throwing up hearts. Album of the year. Let's go. I'm simping for Simbi. Some people are saying that. Some people are simping for you. So
so much love. This is what I mean. Like, it's just like, it just keeps overflowing. And trust me, it's going back your way. So thank you, everyone in the chats and showing love and supporting online. And yeah, I hope to see you guys soon. So
in the next few years, I hope to be in a lot of internet arguments where, you know, people are like, Lil Sims, she's overrated. Lil Sims is so fucking overrated. I hope to be in a lot of arguments where I'm just like, fuck you. She's not overrated.
Get me back on it when that happens, please.
I'll let you know. All right. Please. Have a good one. Well, if not me, I'm sure everybody in the chat here is going to see you at the at your shows. See you at the LA show. I've gotten a lot of tweets of people saying that they've already bought tickets. So, you know, everybody watching right now will see you there.
Amazing. Thank you, guys.
All right. Have a good one.
Peace. Bye.